trouble.
Touch
in my mind, in my will. Hallelujah.
Done. Oh. With us, and if you relative to our liability. And so we know that you are here based upon your own volition, and as an act of your own will, we welcome you. In the event that something beyond our reasonable care efforts is beyond us, we will pick up the phone and call 911. And I just have to say that for just because you just don't know people's medical condition. And so we bless the Lord for you. We just believe this is going to be a time of great intercession and a time of seeking the Lord and believing God for all that He is in us, for all that He will do through us. I want to give you the format of our flow tonight that we have assigned elders and missionaries to continue to facilitate us in the time of prayer and then in the time of teaching. I'm big on teaching. I'm trying to notice that. But it's hard to pray when you don't know what you're praying about.
Amen.
It's hard to ask God for the Holy Ghost when you don't know what it is.
Amen.
And if the only thing you've received is sort of what somebody told you, your mama told you. And that, not that that's not good. It's just that it may not be necessarily all that the Bible says. And so we want to make sure that we have a biblical foundation for what we do. Let me give to some of you a historical context of shut-ins. The Church of God in Christ is all that I know. This is what I was born in. But I'm sure that somebody else is shutting in praying all night, all day. But let me tell you what the purpose of it. The purpose is really to gather the saints in a dedicated time of prayer, fasting, and seeking the Lord around specific areas of need. It is a time to bring our burden to God. It's a time to focus solely on the Word of God and to saturate our spirit with the presence of God.
Amen.
It is really the time that is almost like having an empty tank and coming up, pulling up to the gas station and just asking the person to fill it up. That's what we're asking God to do in this time when we're together. Lord, just fill it up.
Yes.
Because some of us have run on E for a long time.
Amen.
Some of us have just been on E. We've been on a half a tank. We've been on a quarter of a tank. Some of us have been riding on bait. Anybody talking to you? I'm just telling you, I've been there, done that in the natural. Amen? Sometimes you just don't have money, and so you just pray. Oh, I'm the only one.
Yeah.
Pray from destination to destination. I start the car, and I know that's a blessing.
Yeah.
And I ask the Lord to help us
on
that. I'm just telling you where I've been. Amen. And then sometimes, listen, it's good to know where you've been, just in case you ever wind back up there. Saying God that brought you from, my first car was a Plymouth Duster, and it was a hand-me-down from my mama, and the floorboards in the, when you put your feet down, those were gone. So I bought some mats. I bought some mats, and I covered that hole.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Yes, sir. I jumped in that car and drove that car like it was a Mercedes Benz.
Amen.
Amen. I picked up all my friends and we was cruising. Whoever sat next to me in the front knew they had to help keep the feet up. Because if you put your feet down, you're going to go through the cardboard and hit the street.
That's right.
So when we parked, it was the joke that when I start parking, they would pull up the mat and look at the street and say, "Do you need any help?" And it was kind of like a Flintstone mobile. I'm just trying to tell somebody. Because you know what? Folks see you in after you are gone. And they get it twisted like you ain't never been through nothing. Amen. I'm just trying to help you. Just what you see now. Amen. Ooh. It was a long time coming. I'm the only one with that testimony.
Okay.
Look at somebody and say, "Don't get fooled. Don't get fooled. You've been through." And in some cases, still going
through. Yes, sir.
Amen?
Yes, sir.
But our time of the shut-in is really the time to come and to be focused on the presence of the Lord, praying into some specific needs. I posted on Facebook today that we were going to shut in with the saints and ask people to simply give categories of their needs. And the saints from all over the country just posting. And it's the same stuff. Pray for my family. Pray for my health. Pray for my finances. It's the same. We are one everywhere. So I'm going to ask that you would pray for, not only pray for yourself, but intercede for others. Intercede for folk that are going through. And if you're not going through, then spend your time praying for somebody who's going through. Amen? And just believe God for what the Lord is doing. We thank God and we welcome all of our friends and our visitors to this time. some people, some new members of Greater Community said, I've never been in the show, so that's why I'm taking some time to explain what it is.
Yes.
Not just, you know, come on and just pray. No, we're going to pray, then we're going to teach, we're going to worship, we're going to pray, we're going to teach, we're going to worship. We're going to pray, teach, and worship until you decide to let go and let God.
Amen.
And when you let go and let God, then the Lord will, if you do not have the baptism in the Holy Ghost, if you do not have the baptism in the Holy Ghost, He will fill you with the Holy Ghost. But before He fills you, now watch this, I got Bible for this. Jesus taught His disciples before they were filled.
That's right.
Jesus was with His disciples for almost 3 years before He even mentioned the Holy Ghost. He does it really on His way out.
Yes, sir.
Because you have to have a firm understanding of who Jesus is before you can appreciate the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Otherwise, the Holy Spirit is whatever you make it, but it's not what the Bible says.
Okay.
So the shut-in is this time for prayer. You can come when people are coming. They're going to leave when you have to. We're going to, just for security's sake, probably around 11 o'clock, 11:30, we're going to lock the door so that we're locked in. You go from a shut-in to a lock-in.
Yes.
I'm just saying, you know. Hallelujah. You disturb the stuff in the heavenlies and all that. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. So it's going to go from a shut in to a lock in, and then a let out at some point in time. Amen. So when you go out, if you plan on coming back, you need to make sure that you notify somebody who's around that's got a cell phone and you got their number and tell them, oh, listen, I'm going to be back, so I'm going to text you when I'm coming. Amen. So we're going to do that. If you're under a doctor's care and there's something that you need, I pray that you have brought that with you. We just want to be clear. If you need water or something, we have that. If you just run into something, you missed your crackers and juice, we got that. Amen. We can do that. But that's all we need. Because this is new for me, I'm new here. I'm just like letting everybody know. So we got nobody assuming nothing. Amen. We're just telling you. And so before I get into this teaching, and I'm going to probably, my time, whoever's the 10 o'clock person, we'll run over just a little bit, but we got a long way to go. But I didn't want to start this without honoring one of our mothers who, before I got here, matter of fact, while I was in transition, his mother called me and was just so loving and said, Pastor, what do you want to do? Because I usually do a shut-in. I said, well, Mother, keep doing what you're doing. And we will, I said, when I get there, we're going to come up with a different way. Because I understand, I've been doing shut-ins a long time.
All right.
So that's, I'm a young man, but I've been around a long time. I was raised under old saints.
Amen.
So I got an old spirit.
Amen.
And a young body.
Amen.
Amen. So I told her that we would do something different, and she's been so patient to pull this and to wait on me to put other things in place. Usually our shut-ins are going to be on the fifth Friday night. That's part of our evangelism ministry. But because Pentecost is this coming Sunday, I deemed it necessary to move the shut-in to this weekend, and then we'll just do the evangelism training on the fifth Friday night. Good. So keep me right where I was, on the fifth Friday night. And so I called Mother Finner, and I said, I dare not launch this new era of ministry without recognizing and asking her to start us off.
Amen.
And to bless us, because this woman has given herself to fasting and praying. And I called her, and I said, listen, I ain't stupid. I called, I said, hey, listen, I'm doing this, this, and this. Am I missing anything? And then she kind of shared with me, no, it seemed like you got it all together. I said, yeah, I just want to make sure. Because the Bible says that there's safety in the multitude of counsel.
Yeah.
You never want to be on your own doing anything.
That's right.
You want a partner. You want to be with a team just in case you fall. Amen? You need somebody to pick you up. Will you receive our own Mother Finish? She'll come. However, Mother, greet us, whatever you want to say. But we're not starting without your blessing, without you starting us off. Give her a great hand. Thank you.
afternoons and all, a little shaky tonight because I haven't been up in a good while. But I was kind of taken when the pastor called and he asked me, Mother Ferrari, about to shut in. I thank and praise the Lord for allowing me. And there have been some that went with Mother the whole time that I was looking for a certain party that was with me the whole 16 years that the Lord allowed me to be in the shut in. And Mother Young, before she passed, she told me, she said, my baby, she said, you better be sure this is God telling you to do this. Because she said, a lot of times you're going to be here by yourself. Now, if you're looking for a crowd, you're not going to have a crowd. And I told her, I said, Mother, I said, I'm not looking for a crowd. Because it's not in a crowd. All he did, one or two, get together in his name, he'd be in the midst. So, saints, I stand before you tonight. I'm just so blessed. And I thank you, praise God, for giving me a chance to take part in the shutting in. Because what is the Word of God says, some things come that I'm not going to paraphrase in that preaching. Some things come by prayer, but he said some things also come by prayer and fasting. Yes. So there's a difference in just praying, but if you really want to get from God, I dare you to turn that plate down. I remember some of the times that I would come in, pastor, singing it every month. It was time to shut in. The enemy would attack my body. And there have been times I'd come in and I couldn't clap my hands. I tried to clap my hands, I couldn't clap my hands. It was so sore. But then, after the close of the shut in, pain was gone. My knees would start hurting the night of the shut in. And I would tell the enemy, I said, you know what? I'm taking you to the shut in tonight. I'm taking you to the shut in, and you're going to be there right there with me. And when the shut in was over, guess what? The pain left. So I said before you all tonight, the Lord taught me so much in the shut in. In fact, I asked the Lord when I was in the shut in, I said, Lord, teach me to pray. Teach me to pray and teach me to forgive. I have a habit of not forgiving. If you did something to me, I held on to it for a while. And that was not right. And Pastor, I tell you, things have been done and said to me that I yet can forgive and love that person. The Lord has blessed me just tremendously so. I remember when Pastor first came, he told me he was going to revamp the shut-in. I said, Pastor, I said, you know what? I said, whatever you do with the shut-in, I said, I'll be there. I will be there and I'll take a part.
That's what you said.
Whoever you put over, I'll be there with you. Mother, you don't have to be over anything. The years the Lord has blessed me to work in the church, I worked in every capacity there is to work in the church. So, Mother, you don't have to be up. I like to be a help.
That's right.
But I don't have to be over anything. And if I know anything, I will share. He says, free and you receive, free and you share and you give. And I will share and give that to you all. I love to sing, Pastor, but I can't.
Hey, Mother?
I didn't ask Faith up here to help Mom. The last time I got up, I said, Faith, I'm going to sing a song. Would you help, Mother? only one thing I would give anything for.
Yeah.
And when he passed, thanks, y'all looking at somebody that's blessed.
My mind.
You hear me?
Thank you, Lord.
I miss him sometimes, but I gave him my all.
Yes.
And you know what? I was in a church in Los Angeles, California, and the pastor was in the room with me, and I looked down at him, and I went over to him, and I said, Lord, I said, look like he's getting weak. I said, what God are you going to do? You've got to assure me that he's going to be a blessing.
Yes.
I said, you just got to assure me. You've got to give me that assurance that I'm going to take it. That's just my baby.
Yes.
This is my baby child.
Mama.
I said, but if you're going to take it, you've got to give me your assurance. And he had not been talking. He had stopped talking. Back to me. And I walked back over to the bed and I said, Bam, I call him Bam, his name is Ronell. I said, Bam, he said, hmm? I said, he said, thank the Lord. He said, thank the Lord. I said, say, Lord, forgive me. He said, Lord, forgive me.
Thank you, Jesus.
I said, say, Lord, thank you, Jesus, for saving me. He said that, and me and the pastor was in the room. He was in there with me, and my son and pastor went to that room.
Thank you, Jesus.
We literally tore that room up. You know that? That boy didn't speak another word after that.
My God.
You know, my son told me, Mommy, why don't you go home and get you some rest? And the only thing I didn't understand at the time, I said, well, why did you let me go home, knowing my son was going to leave me? But saints, you not know that the Lord knows how much we can bear.
Yeah.
And he knows what we can take and what we can't take.
Yeah.
And the church mother told me, I said, well, I don't understand. The only thing I understand is I'm going to leave you home. She said, baby, the Lord knew you could come out here and take it in for 3 years, like you did. But he knew that you would be able to take him taking his last breath and close his eyes. So he sent you home.
Thank you,
and left the son out there for him. And I said, I thank him
for
doing that.
Yeah.
And saints, do you not know, I just thank you, praise the Lord. I thank you, praise the Lord, for how he took care of me and brought me back here to Georgia, and I called Georgia my home. I was talking, but I didn't know what you wanted me to do. I didn't spend my mind. I was going to give a testimony. I didn't know what you wanted me to do, Pastor. But I'm just here. Just here in the city. But I just want to leave that testimony with you all. Whenever the pastor calls, I shut in. We are to be here. It'll pay you to be here.
Amen.
I'm telling you what I know and what I've gone through. Do you hear me?
Thank you, Jesus.
Do you hear me, ministry? Do y'all hear me? Y'all be here. Y'all hear me, mother? Y'all be here. Y'all be here. It pays. You want your children saved? You want your grandchildren saved? He'll do it.
He will do it.
You want your money,
that's right.
More money in your pocket? He'll take what you got and he'll double it.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm telling you, that's what he'll do for you.
Yeah.
People are coming and giving you money and you don't know why they're giving you money.
Jesus.
Do you hear me? I'm still spending birthday money. My birthday's in
heaven.
Mama. I'm still spending birthday money.
Thank you, Lord.
It's just a blessing.
Hallelujah.
It's a blessing. You know what? Once you get accustomed to doing what you're supposed to do, it becomes a part of you.
Yeah.
Let this become a part of you.
Yeah.
Let this become a part of you.
Thank you.
It's to call anybody, y'all come out and help him.
That's right.
You know what, see, now, I didn't have the grit and help that I really needed. I really didn't have it. But you know what, see, it never bothered me. I never had the mind to quit.
My
I never did.
Yeah.
If it came, it came. If it didn't come, it didn't come. But the shutting went on.
That's right.
And it went on for years.
Right.
You hear me, Pastor?
Yes, ma'am.
So, Pastor, you're here now in Georgia. So, you're here now. And so, we're here with you.
Amen.
And we're going to be praying with you.
Thank
I'll
you.
Be here every time I can be here. Lord, give me the strength, I'll be here.
Amen.
Because this has become a part of my life. And I really believe the reason why the Lord has been good to me and my two boys. I've got two boys left. And the reason why he's been good to them is because of the prayers I've put up and gone up before them. My kids very quick, my son had told me, he said, Mama, I want to make a $2,000 a week pay. He want to make $2,000 one week. I said, okay, you got to work to make it now. You know that. Mama, I just want you to pray for me. I said, all right, baby, Mama, pray for you. Pastor, don't call me this week and tell me this week he's going to bring me $2,000. I hope you all blessed because of this journey. That's what we're doing tonight. It's shutting me. Y'all pray for Mother Summer. I'll pray for you all.
Amen.
Thank you.
The aspects of prayer is like driving a car, a standard that's got a stick shift. You know, you start in first, and then you can tell that I don't drive a stick. And then you start sliding second, right? But watch this. You slide because you get so good, people that I've rode with, they hear the motor. And so they know when to shift, and they shift like seamlessly.
Yeah.
If I'm shifting, it's like this, you know? But the point is that they shift and they get to whatever fifth gear or sixth gear. Is there a sixth? Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. Lord, you've always got to be so know-it-all. Y'all know what I'm trying to say. My point is, fence. But then when you start slowing down, you've got to back them down. Or break it down. Sorry. You got to break it down.
Now,
forget it. I'm going to use another one now. But the point is, you got to break it down back to one. And then you got to start the process all over again. If you understand that little analogy, that little metaphor, then that's the same way we pray. You do not have to pray and start off in fifth gear. Because by the time you get to fifth, you had adoration, blessing, and everything else. But you need to start off in one. You need to lay an expectation before the Lord. You need to come before God with an expectation. So what's going to make the shut-in work for you? You have to declare an expectation.
Right, right.
God is waiting, watch this, to hear what you want. And so if you come here to say, I'm just coming for strength, then you're going to leave with some strength. Listen, if Mother Finner can pray a $2,000 a week prayer, then, listen, hallelujah. I'm going to just get next to Mother Finner. Say, I need more than $2,000 a week. Hallelujah. I got kids in college. Hallelujah. But my point is, you have to make an expectation. Say with me, expectation. So tonight and through this time that you'll share with us, you have to stay in that expectation. Now, whatever you declare that you want God to do, then that's where you need to stay until you get that release, till you get that insight, till you get that understanding and that strategy. Don't pray for this, for A, between the hours of, 11 and 12, and then pray for B between 12 and 1, and C between 1 and 2, and D between 2 and 3. Stick with your expectation and understand the word of God around it. And watch God work.
Amen.
When you pray, you don't have to use a lot of words either. Some prayer is just going to be a crying out of our spirit. And I really want to say to the facilitators, let's not bring people or drive them to a place of our prayer, but let's lead them in prayer. And let's sense where people are. And stay in that. Sometimes you got everything you want to pray about and really, really need that one thing. Because we need to learn how to linger with God.
Amen.
How to be in God's presence. So you have to create an expectation. In Luke chapter 18, verse 1, and he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Saying, there was in the city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city. And she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. And he would not. And he would not for a while. But afterward, he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge saith, and shall not God avenge his own elect chosen, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? I want to just really lay this foundation about the necessity of prayer. And Mother talked about it when she talked about her son, that he said, Mom, I want to do this, but I need you to pray. I want to share with you that as we go through this shut-in, your prayer time is going to be critically important to you receiving what you desire from the Lord.
Amen.
We've got to take a look at prayer again. And we must say, as a body of baptized believers, I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time in my emotion. I'm going to spend time asking God specifically for what I want.
Amen.
Now, can I say something to you? If you develop your expectation tonight, you will walk out of this season, even on Sunday, and the manifestation of your expectation will be revealed.
Amen.
God will do it simply because you pray.
Yeah.
You know that you got to take God at his word?
Yeah.
God has nothing else but His Word. And He watches over His Word to perform it in your life. But He needs to know, what do you want? You can look in Scripture and see that times of prayer has always been around you creating an expectation. And so the woman that whose sons were about to be taken, because she was her husband was part of the school of the prophets, she came and said, we got some problems and they're about to take my son. He said, what do you want? She said, I want you to do something. He says, what do you have in your house? And so she begins to say, I have nothing in my house save a little pot of oil. He says, then go get many vessels. Y'all know this. Go get many vessels. The point that I'm trying to lift out of that particular text is that he focused her on her expectation, because she came to him for a solution. Tonight, we come to God for a specific request. What is it that you want from the Lord? And whatever it is that you want from God, then now you sit in that and you pray into that and you read the Scripture, you hear everyone that's going to be teaching, you hear that and apply that principle to your life and watch God work in you.
Amen.
Are we here? So prayer is the privilege God has granted every believer to communicate directly with Him. Now, Job 22, 26, and 27 says, for then shalt thou have thy delight in the Almighty, and shall live up, and shall live up thy face, lift up thy face unto God. Thou shalt make thy prayer unto Him, and He shall hear thee. This is the one thing I want you to know. Why do you have to create an expectation? Because God don't hear you.
Amen.
Yes, yes.
Okay, one more time. Why do I need an expectation? Because God's going to hear me.
Amen.
Will you say it with me tonight? God's hearing me tonight.
God's hearing me tonight.
Now watch this. I don't have to scream for Him to hear me.
Oh,
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to hear you. But my point is, you don't have to scream for Him to hear you. You can whisper and He'll hear you. You can groan and He'll hear you. You can cry out and He will hear you. Matter of fact, you can sit silently and cry, and your tears are liquid prayer. Your tears are liquid prayer. Because God knows. Has anybody besides me ever been hurt so bad that you got no words to come out in your prayer? And so you've been wounded so deeply that you just sit there and rock and you cry. Well, God hears your prayer, because he is omnipotent. And so I want to share with you that tonight God will hear you if you set an expectation. If you say that I've got this troubled child and they have this specific issue, and I'm believing God tonight, I do battle with the enemy over the future of my daughter or my son, and I decree in my life that this issue is going to be resolved tonight. That when the sun rises, this problem is going to be over, because I'm going to spend the night wrestling with God like Jacob did with the angel. And he says, you got to let me go because of the breaking of day. He says, I'm not letting you go until you bless me. I have an expectation of you. I've been living this way too long. I'm tired of living looking over my shoulder. I'm tired of being called a trickster and all that. Bless me.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So when you get specific about what you want, then God gets specific about delivering.
Amen. Amen.
Because watch what God will not do. God will not cancel your faith. It is your faith. For without faith, come on, Hebrews 11 and 6. For without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is what? He is God. And that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek. And so I need to run, because now I want to make sure that I keep the schedule. But let me just share this, that prayer is our privilege that has been granted to every believer. And this is the thing. God has granted you the privilege to pray. So you need to take advantage of the privilege.
Yes, sir.
He says, if you pray, I'll hear. If you speak, I will hear and attend unto your cry. He did it with Israel. Israel cried out unto the Lord. And notice the language in Scripture that Israel cries and God hears. Because in this cry meant that they passionately went after God concerning a specific thing. They cried by reason of their taskmasters, and the Lord sent a deliverer. If you will cry out unto God, God will send a deliverance your way.
Amen.
If you decide tonight that this is the thing. thing I'm praying about, this is the thing that's going to be broken in my life. If there's a bondage, if there's an issue, if there's a need, if there is a request, if there is a desire, then you say, here is my expectation, Lord, and this is what I'm believing that you will make happen in my life simply because I pray.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Are you here?
Yeah.
This widow, now, and here, and Jesus speaks a parable. This widow comes to this unjust judge who could care less about God or man. Notice, the only thing that made him change his mind is the widow kept coming.
Amen.
Do you say to somebody, you got to keep coming.
You
got to keep coming to God. You got to keep going after him. I tell people this all the time. I tell them when they want something from the Lord, I say, well, then Luke 18. If I ever tell you the Luke 18 God, this is exactly what I'm talking about. And if I tell people, if you're looking for a job, Luke 18.
Yeah.
If you're going for an interview, Luke 18. If there's something you want, Luke 18. Just keep going until, watch this, that person on the job say, you know what, I'm sick of you. Didn't you call yesterday? Yes, I did. And watch this, you call the next day,
yeah.
You call the next day, and you call the next day, and you call the next day. And all of a sudden, they go from aggravation to respect.
That's right.
Right.
It moves from respect to relationship.
Right.
And then when they hear your voice, oh, I know what you're calling about. You serious about this, huh? Because you got to break down some stuff.
Right.
You got to let people know and the devil know that you're serious about what you want. And watch this. God is sitting back waiting for you to Luke 18.
Yeah.
I said, God's waiting for you to Luke 18.
Yes, sir.
And so maybe there's some stuff in your life that has not been manifested because you quit because you got tired.
Right.
You quit because you got frustrated.
Yeah.
You quit because somebody told you it's not going to happen. You quit because you just got discouraged. But if you like this widow and this unjust judge, after a while, it's not even about what God is going to do, how God is going to intervene. He already gave her power. She said, you know what? I'm going to just keep coming after you. And I'm going to wear you down until God wears you out. And so tonight, I lay this foundation that if you are not filled with the Holy Ghost, ask the Lord to fill you.
Amen.
If there's an issue in your life that needs to be fixed, then focus on that and say, it is my expectation that when the sun rises,
Amen.
This issue will be completed. When the sun comes up, this thing's going to be done. Because tonight, I didn't come for you to see me. I didn't come to look at you. I didn't come to hear. I came to be with God. And watch this. I'm going to wrestle with him until he does something in me. Because can I tell you something? God's going to do the work in you first. Y'all got to get this, and I'm going to let you go. Well, watch this. God is going to do the work in you first. So if you come with an expectation, the second thing you have to come is with an openness.
Yeah, right.
You've got to be open to say, God, I'm open to whatever you'll say concerning this.
Yeah.
I'm open to however you will move me concerning this.
Yeah.
And so this is what I want you to get. Establish an expectation and then be open to God. When you establish an expectation, you ought to walk away from the thing that you asked him for. And now you've already laid it out. Now thank him for it. And keep looking. Come on, y'all.
Amen.
Because why? I prayed about it.
Right.
So there's a couple of things you can do. Either you can act like the centurion. And the centurion said, you don't have to come to my house. Just speak the word. Or you can be the widow and keep coming. So watch this. Don't let people tell you, well, if you prayed about it, you need to leave it alone and God's going to do it because you don't believe God. No, God gives a whole bunch of ways that you can pray. Stop putting people in one box and telling them, that's your experience. That ain't my experience. Maybe I want to keep going to the pot and see if the water's boiling. Maybe that's my prerogative. You know, that's how I roll. That's the way I'm wired. Maybe you can just sit there and say, a watch pot never boils. But watch this. It boils sometimes. You just didn't see when I want to see the bubbles. I want to see the little bubbles. I want to see the little bubbles. I want to see all the little bubbles and then they turn into big bubbles.
That's right.
That's just who I am. I want to see the process.
That's right.
Some people don't want to see that. They can go and just wait and oh, it's boiling now. It's done. But don't put somebody in a box that doesn't fit in your experience. Because the Bible says that the centurion said, don't come to my house, speak the word. The widow, she keeps coming every day. There's a whole bunch of other scriptures. scriptures where people deal differently in prayer. So however you're wired, go after God that way. But be open that God is going to deal with you before he deals with it. Come on, I'm trying to lay a foundation. I say God's going to deal with you before he deals with it. Do not ask God to do something to it for it to them without first saying, do something to me. God, it's me. I need you to do something in my life. I need you to correct my thinking. I need you to change my heart. I need you to change my language. Because watch this. When God changes you, then it changes automatically. Man, I'm trying to teach in this house about prayer. When you believe God for you, then God automatically takes care of it. So he says, not that I fear God nor regard man, but because they're continue coming. So let me give you the elements of prayer and I'm out. The first thing, one element is adoration. The Bible gives us multiple approaches that we can utilize in prayer. So adoration is the spontaneous yearning of the heart to worship, to honor, to magnify, to praise, and to bless God. To adore him is to recognize and appreciate his love, his handiwork, his power, and his majesty. And Matthew, if you're taking notes, Matthew 22:37 is this whole piece about adoration, where we come to adore God. Can I say something to you? That your prayer ought to include adoration. Matter of fact, you ought to start with adoration. You ought to start blessing the Lord for all that he is. Can I help? This is what I call it, a top-down prayer, not bottom-up. Top-down praying is when we start with adoration. Bottom-up praying is when we start with the problem. Oh, Jesus. Lord, my cable bill, my marriage, my health. You start bringing the problem. But adoration is top down. I thank you for who you are. Because if you ever get lost in who he is, then watch this. Your problem's going to get lost in your adoration. If you get lost in that aspect of prayer where you will adore God, you will lift him up and you will declare that he's God no matter what's going on with you. And you begin to unpack God's name. That you're El Shaddai, you're Jehovah Jireh, you're Jehovah Sekenu, you're Jehovah Rapha, you're Jehovah Shammah. Come on, when you begin to unpack that he's your peace, he's your banner, he's your righteousness, he's your sanctification. When you begin to say that you're El Shaddai, you're more than sufficient for everything in my life. You are God. I extol you. I bless you. I lose myself in worship. You'll forget your petition. Adoration. Second one is confession. The believer does not practice sin. However, God has made the prayer of confession available. He has given each believer the opportunity to admit and acknowledge sin in one's life and dependence in the need for God's mercy. 1 John 1:9. Now, we don't practice sin, but I'm going to tell you something. After your adoration, you need to confess, Lord, I've fallen short. And listen, and don't let the enemy fool you in public prayer. Don't let the enemy fool you in public prayer. Because I know how the church works. All the church tricks. You know the church tricks is somebody gets up and they start confessing. They be like, ooh, what's going on with him? It ain't none of your business. First of all, ain't nothing going on with them. They just clearing the slate. And if you spend some time confessing over what you just did, so you just canceled yourself out of prayer because you criticizing somebody that prayed. So you just need to go home now. Oh, come on. You know I'm telling you. You need to get up and confess. Father, forget. I do it all the time. If I even thought, Job had nothing to confess about, but he says, Lord, just in case my kids messed up in your presence, just in case they did something they wasn't supposed to do, forgive them. And so it is the prayer of confession. The third one is prayer of thanksgiving. Prayer of thanksgiving springs from a grateful heart. Expressions of appreciation are uttered for his blessing, his past blessings, present and future blessings. Colossians 3:1. And then 1 Thessalonians 5:18. Thanksgiving displays the believer's faith and awareness that God is in full control of their life. When you go from adoration to confession to thanksgiving, to say, God, I thank you. And I heard Sister Gail say Sunday to stay in the thank you. It is to stay in a place where you are grateful to God, even if he doesn't work this situation that you're in now. If he don't work that out, he worked the one before that. Man, I want to shout on that. Listen, God, if you don't work this one out, I thank you for working the other one out, the one before this. And if you can thank God for working out the one before this, then he'll work this one out too. But the real issue is, it's about gratitude. We don't come to God out of ownership, are we here? And then this is the one that we will lay in for a while in this time, this season together, and that's intercession. Intercession is to petition God on behalf of others, or request for God to intervene in the circumstance. Anybody got any circumstances that you want God to intervene? You want God to step into? You want God to step into some circumstance. There are many examples of biblical characters who stood in the gap. Yet there is none greater than our Lord Jesus, who, while facing death on the cross, asked that forgiveness be granted to those that were guilty. He said, Father, forgive them. He was interceding on the cross. And so we come to intercede on behalf of our families. We come to ask God to fill us with the Holy Ghost, refill us, give us another filling. And so I want you to begin to now think through your expectation. I want you to think, to really begin to say, God, I have expectation of you. And so whoever's next in the prayer shift, get ready to come and pray. Because what I would like for you to do is start. Now, this is the other thing. Facilitators, wherever the speaker ends, you come in and pray into that. And then move us to the next place. You see how? So it's always a progression. I'm teaching while I'm on the floor. It's just important so that we have the flow. But so, you need to create an expectation. Whatever you will pray, if you pray, if you have an expectation tonight and you are open to the Lord, then I promise you, according to God's word, that God will do exactly what you ask. Matthew 7:7 is very clear. Ask and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door, come on, it shall be open. It shall be open to you. God has promised that he's going to open the door if you will what? Pray. Come on, if you pray. If you pray, if you say, God, this is my expectation. I'm believing you tonight for whatever that is. And so tonight, I just have an expectation of God. My prayer all month, beginning May 1st, was that God would fill this house. That's just my expectation. That the glory of God, said in the 7 a.m. prayer, that the fire of God will fall on the altar of God, that the people of God may be consumed. What's your expectation, Pastor? The fire of God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
The fire of God. That's my expectation. The fire of God. That's what I expect God to do. I expect God to consume us in the fire of God, on the altar of God, that the people of God may be consumed. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Come on, right there where you are. Begin to develop that expectation. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on, that expectation. Begin to develop that expectation. I believe. I have expectation. I have expectation of you tonight. I believe. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you because you are God. Lord, we thank you because you are healer. Lord, we thank you because you are our provider. Lord, we thank you because you've been our keeper. Lord,
I just want to
try this and throw in depression and drama. We come against utter shock. Everything that is counterculture to your power. But we tear down spiritual walls. And we proclaim that they must come down. The kingdom of God be at work in this place. The kingdom of God be done. We pray for the band of wickedness. Evil in this place must go. Through the authority of your word. Through the blood of Jesus. Burn up the satanic altar.
opportunity. I would like to thank all the elders, everyone in their respective. Our scripture reading for this evening is John 3:6-8.
Yes.
John 3:6-8.
Yes.
When you have it, you please say amen. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again.
Yeah.
And the wind bloweth where it listeth.
Yeah.
And thou hearest the sound thereof, but cannot tell whence thereof, but cast not tell whence it cometh, and whither it goeth.
Mm-hmm.
So is everyone that is born of the spirit.
Yeah.
Father God, I thank you now for this moment in time.
Thank you, Jesus.
God, I ask you right now for a moment.